lead us today, okay?
We stand and lift up our hands for the joy of the Lord is our strength. We bow down and worship Him now. How great, how awesome is He. Together we sing. Everyone sing, holy is the Lord God Almighty. The earth is filled with His glory. Holy is the Lord God Almighty. The earth is filled with His glory. Filled with His glory.
Let's sing that all again. We stand.
We stand and lift up our hands, for the joy of the Lord is our strength. We bow down and worship Him now. How great, how awesome is He. Together we sing, everyone sing, holy is the Lord God Almighty. The earth is filled with His glory, holy is the Lord God. Filled with His glory. The earth is filled with His glory. And it's rising up. It's all around. It's the anthem of the Lord's renown. And it's rising up. It's all around. It's the anthem. Together we sing, everyone sing, holy is the Lord God Almighty. The earth is filled with His glory, holy is the Lord God. Is filled with His glory. Holy is the Lord God Almighty. The earth is filled with His glory. Holy is the Lord God Almighty. The earth is filled with His glory. Filled with His glory.
Lord, thank You for this song that reminds us that You are indeed holy. And Lord, if we need to go looking for Your goodness, and if we need to go looking for Your glory, Lord, the whole earth is filled with it. We just need to look at Your creation, see how good and how awesome You are, Lord. Lord, help us to be still in times of trouble. Help us to be alert in times of peace. Lord, and we ask that we be aware of Your presence in every step that we take, in every moment of our lives. This is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. All right, cool. Before you have a seat, if you're already in the middle, great. If you are not, if you will just squeeze down, so just shift your row. Everybody doesn't have to be like in these two seats, right? We want two seats in between. But everyone just come down into the middle just a little bit. Thank you, I appreciate that. It's a lot easier to talk to a group that's like this instead of way off. We start usually each lesson with a question, and today is no different. Is our question up there? It is. Why is it hard to talk about Jesus with your friends? Discuss this for maybe, 30 seconds. Around you, discuss, ready, go. Why is it hard to talk about Jesus with your friends? What do you got? Someone share. Why is it hard to talk to Jesus? I mean, talk to our friends about Jesus. In the back. Sure.
Because maybe the person doesn't want to know about Jesus.
Absolutely.
Because we don't know how they're going to perceive us after we talk to them.
Sure.
Because even if you don't want to be that one person that's like always talking about that stuff.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah. Sure.
They might judge you. Because it's a serious topic.
It's a serious topic? Absolutely.
It doesn't really come up in conversation.
It doesn't come up that often. Absolutely. Last one.
It's
a sensitive topic. Yeah, it can be sensitive. Good. There's lots of other stuff, and we're going to jump into what this means in just a second and talk a little bit more about this question. But before that, I want to remind you all of kind of what we're talking about. Our lesson series is called All Up and All Out. And it kind of comes from this scripture we talked about the first week, which is going to be on the screen, Ephesians 5, verses 1 through 2. We're going to read it together, everybody in unison, on three. One, two, three. Imitate God, therefore, in everything you do, because you are his dear children. Live a life filled with love, following the example of Christ. So from this scripture, we kind of like take on two important things. One is, like, we're called to imitate God. And we talked about, like, if we want to imitate something, if we want to copy something, we have to focus on it. If you're not focused on it, you can't copy what someone does, right? If you're playing Simon Says, you have to give your full attention, your full focus to whoever's leading if you want to imitate them the way you're supposed to. And so as Christians, our focus is upward on God. Yet, we're called to live a life filled with love, following the example of Christ. And what that means is that even though our focus is up on God, the direction of our lives, what we do, is serve and love the people outside ourselves. So we're all up and we're all out. We have an up focus with an outward direction for our lives. And last week, we talked about this idea that service is love expressed through action. So if we like love someone, we could say like, hey, I love you. But if we never act on that, people don't believe us, right? Like I tell Christina, hey, I love you, but I'm mean to her. I don't spend time with her. I don't do nice things for her. It probably doesn't feel like I love her. But if I say I love her and then I do nice things for her, I talk to her, I spend time with her, right? It feels like I love her because love is a verb. Love is expressed through action, and that's what we call serve. When we serve someone, it's literally just love expressed through action instead of words. And sometimes it is words, but we'll get into that in just a second. Because one of the most important reasons we serve, it's not the only important reason, but one of the most important is because it enables us to share God's love. If we want to share God's love, or somebody comes and talks to me at the church, whether they are your age, whether they're younger, whether they're like much, much older, maybe they're like 80 years old, and they come and they say, I want to share God's love. How do I do that? And I would tell them, like, serve people. Because if we're honest, sometimes it's really hard to talk about Jesus, especially to our friends. When we're at school, it doesn't come up in conversation. We're scared or worried that someone's going to judge us. We're worried about offending someone else. We don't have the words to say. Like, talking about Jesus is really hard. And not just right now, but talking about Jesus is always hard. You guys gave so many different reasons, and all those reasons are true about why it's difficult. That doesn't mean we never need to do it. But the primary way we share God's love isn't through talking about it. And one of the big reasons we don't, it's not just about talking, is because we've all met somebody who talks about Jesus and wants to share Jesus' love, but they don't act like it. Like, we've all met people who are saying, oh yeah, I go to church, I'm a Christian, I love all people, but then the way they act, it doesn't share God's love at all. And so we have to be careful, because we don't want to do that. And so the best way, and we're focused on our friends here, because you're going to see in our scripture in just a second, that our friends are people that we have contact with all the time that we can serve and love. The best way to share God's love in any capacity, in any way, with any person, is to live it out, is to serve them. It's to express God's love through how we act, how we treat people, how we talk to people. It's not just saying God loves you. It's living out a life. And my life, the example I set, says God love you. Because I can say it all day, and if I'm not living like it, I'm going to push you away. I am going to offend you. Right? Most people who don't want to talk about Jesus, or think they don't like church, or they don't like religion, one of the main reasons is because they've met somebody who says, this is, I represent Jesus and Jesus loves you, but I'm going to treat you really, really bad. And so that person is like, wait, all Christians are like that? I don't want any of that. And so what we have to do as people is we get to share that love without even saying it, by our actions. And we're going to see that in our scripture today from Mark chapter 2, verses 1 through 12. This is a really, really awesome scripture about being a good friend. And we're all called to be this kind of friend in here. When Jesus returned to Capernaum several days later, the news spread quickly that he was back home. Soon, the house where he was staying was so packed with visitors that there was no more room, even outside the door. While he was preaching God's word to them, four men arrived carrying a paralyzed man on a mat. They couldn't bring him to Jesus because of the crowd, so they dug a hole through the roof above his head. Then they lowered the man on his mat right down in front of Jesus. Seeing their faith, Jesus said to the paralyzed man, "My child, your sins are forgiven." But some of the teachers of the religious law who were sitting there thought to themselves, "What is he saying? This is blasphemy. Only God can forgive sins." Jesus knew immediately what they were thinking. So he asked them, "Why do you question this in your hearts? Is it easier to say to the paralyzed man, 'Your sins are forgiven,' or 'Stand up, pick up your mat, and walk'? So I will prove to you that the Son of Man has the authority on earth to forgive sins." Then Jesus turned to the paralyzed man and said, "Stand up, pick up your mat, and go home." And the man jumped up, grabbed his mat, and walked out through the stunned onlookers. They were all amazed and praised God, exclaiming, "We've never seen anything like this before." I'm going to pray, then we're going to jump into this scripture. Dear God, we thank you for today. I thank you for each one of these students. I ask that you bless them, that you pour your Holy Spirit out into them, that all of us can grow, can become more like you, can experience your love tonight. I pray this in your holy name. Amen. So, our story here. Jesus comes to this town and he starts preaching. And Jesus is starting to get pretty famous here. So when people hear Jesus is coming to town, like, they just flock in. And they didn't have like big churches or stadiums or anything like that to preach in. So they're in this house. And so many people start flooding in. It's like the opposite of COVID, right? Everybody is packed in as tightly as possible. And they're all listening to Jesus, which is awesome and cool. And what it should look like when people live and act like Jesus is people want to be around it. But they crowd into this house. And while Jesus is teaching, like little bits of the roof start to fall down. Maybe one even falls on his head. Maybe it falls near him, right? This like roof starts to fall down and more of it comes in, and then it becomes a distraction where like everybody now is watching the roof and these people like slowly lowering their friend through the house. And you can imagine, right? Like that person who owned the house is probably mad and they're like, what is this person doing? There's a hole in my roof now. When it rains, right? The rain is going to come in. But what was going on is these four friends had this other friend who was paralyzed, couldn't walk. And they heard Jesus was in town. And what they've heard about this man, Jesus, is not only he loves people, right? But like he does these amazing miracles. Things nobody's seen or heard about before. He heals people. And these four friends, they look at their other friend and they say, we got to get this guy to Jesus, right? Like he's paralyzed, but Jesus, he's done amazing things. And if we can only get this guy to Jesus, Jesus is going to take care of the rest. So they like think about what they're going to do. They probably are carrying him or helping him, like carry his, you know, carrying his mat, taking him. And they get to the house and they were running late and it was already packed. Like they couldn't get through because everybody wanted to be about Jesus. And it's really interesting because they could have gave up right here, right? They tried to get their friend to Jesus. I mean, they literally carried him all the way there, you know? Then maybe they took off work that day or they skipped school just so they could get this guy to Jesus. And they could have given up, but they said, you know what? We're going to get our friend to Jesus no matter what. And so they take him to the roof and they start like making a hole in this stranger's roof. And they lower him down. Jesus sees the man lowered down. And the first thing he says, and this is really interesting, he says, you're forgiven, child. He doesn't heal him right away. He forgives his sin because he knows that's the biggest hole in all of our hearts, in all of our lives. The thing we desire most is to be close and one with God. And it's our sin that separates us. So he says, you're forgiven, child. And then these religious leaders, these are all the Pharisees. These are the people who eventually put Jesus on trial and kill him. They're the people who hate Jesus because Jesus is changing things in a way they don't want changed. And these Pharisees, they don't even say out loud these things. They're just thinking in their head what negative thoughts, complaining. How can he do this? Look at that house. Look at the mess. This isn't how it's supposed to be. They have this negative mindset. And the thing that's interesting is maybe Jesus read their mind. But you know what I think? I think Jesus just saw the way they acted, saw their faces, read their body language. Because the truth is when somebody thinks bad about someone else, they don't have to say it. You can tell. And maybe you haven't experienced this, but just because someone doesn't actively say something about someone else, doesn't mean they're treating them with love and kindness. And the thing is, Jesus knew, like, these people have this negative attitude, and he sees it. He knows what they're thinking, and so he addresses them, and he's like, are you people crazy? Like, do you know what I just did for this man? And then he tells him, get up. Take your mats. And, you're healed. And the guy gets up, and he's excited. He picks up his mat. He walks for the first time in who knows how long. And he goes out, and everybody is amazed. And that's how our story ends. But one of the things I love so much about this scripture, did y'all catch it? In verse 5, seeing their faith, Jesus said to the paralyzed man, my child, your sins are forgiven. Jesus didn't say seeing his faith. Jesus said seeing their faith. Plural. Like the group of friends and him, seeing all of their faith, Jesus forgives and heals this man. Jesus is recognizing the importance of friends who have faith in him. When we have friends who have faith, it propels us to also have faith. This doesn't mean we shove our faith down our friends' throats. No one has ever been argued into being a Christian. No one has ever been judged into being a Christian. No one has ever been forced into being a Christian. Being a Christian means that that person comes to the conclusion that Jesus died on the cross for them, and they need that in their life. Instead, we simply live out our faith, and that in itself helps to invite others to want the same faith we have. And this scripture is pointing that out. People that follow Jesus carry their friends to Jesus. People who follow Jesus carry their friends to Jesus. And what does this look like? Do we literally have to pick up our friends and carry them to church? Well, you certainly can go and give them a ride to church, but that's not what this is talking about. It's much deeper than that. For us, it's not so much carrying our friends to Jesus, but instead it is carrying Jesus to our friends. As Christians, when we say, Jesus, I want you in my heart, I want you in my life, I want to follow you, what that means is Jesus is always with us. When we go to school, when we go to practice, when we're at home, Jesus is there. And now we have a choice whether we act like him or not, whether we live it out. He's there. But when we do act like Jesus, then we are sharing Jesus with people. We are literally taking Jesus with us and sharing him with the world. When we love and serve our friends, we are literally carrying Jesus to them. This is one of the best things we can do as friends. Sometimes this involves talking about Jesus. Sometimes it does. And that is hard for all those reasons you talked about. And sometimes we're going to have hard conversations. But most of the time, hear me out, most of the time, it is just loving and serving our friends. And that's how we share Jesus with them. Jesus calls us to be great friends. And this is example from our scripture of that. The best way we can share like Jesus with our friends is just by loving them. That's it. It's not complicated. And so how do we do it? How do we carry Jesus to our friends? What does it mean to be a great friend? What does it mean to serve our friends? It means we help them out. It means we encourage them. We build them up. It means we listen to them. It means we lovingly challenge them to grow. Good friends will, like, not judge someone else, right? They won't judge them. And when they do something wrong, it's just like, whatever, you know, I'm not doing that, but it's whatever. Great friends lovingly challenge them to grow, like to step away from things that are bad and destructive. Being a great friend, it means that sometimes we have to have tough conversations. Sometimes we got to talk about those things. Sometimes we got to talk about Jesus. Sometimes we got to talk about politics. Sometimes we got to talk about like behavior that is hurting things. Sometimes we got to talk about issues in our friendship. Sometimes we have to have tough conversations if we're going to be great friends. Being a great friend means that we're there for them both in the good and bad days and everything in between. It means we're honest with our friends. It means we put them above ourselves. This is like the biggest thing. If you really want to love and serve your friends and show them God's love, like, and be different than all the other people at school, you got to put other people's wants and needs above your own. And that is hard to do. Being a good friend is hard. It takes work. It's not just being a good friend when it's convenient. Like when we feel good, when things are going good, on the good days. Being a great friend means that we do all these things when it's tough. When things aren't going our way. And being a great friend is getting someone's back. It's helping them to do what is right. It's acting like Jesus towards them. It is serving them. It's just loving them. If we can be friends like that, our friends will come to know God's love. Maybe not tomorrow, maybe not like next week, maybe not in a year, maybe not in 4 years, but eventually they will come to know God's love because of the way we serve them. And this is one of the main methods of sharing our faith. It's love expressed through action. And it's tough, like I get that. But it's not complicated. We can all be better friends. And when we are, we show God's love. So we're going to kind of close with these two questions. What friends of yours need to know God's love? Think right now in your head. What friends of yours need to know God's love? And then think about this, is how can you show it to them? I'm not even asking you to go out and preach a sermon to them. I'm not asking you to go, like, you can invite them to church, you can do all that stuff, that's great. But if you're going to make an impact in the people around you, if you really want your friends to come to know Jesus, you got to love and serve them. So how can you show it to them? Let's pray, and then we got a few things left. Dear God, we just thank you for today. We thank you for all that you've given us. We thank you for our friends. We thank you that you created us for friendship. God, help us to live like you. Help us to be a friend like you. Help us to love and serve our friends because we want them to know you. We want them to know your love. We want them to experience life with you. So help us to show that and express that through the way we live and serve. In your name, amen. Amen. Cool. So we have the results. Would one of my assistants bring them up?
Also, if you want to introduce our new friend.
Oh, sure.
The girls know everybody.
Yes, yes, yes. You all, this is Katie.
Hi.
Katie, wave. Tell us what your favorite food is.
My favorite food? Okay, are we talking like side dish or snack food?
Both.
Okay, so side dish is macaroni and cheese. Oh, yeah. But like the shells and cheese.
Yeah.
And then snack food is either Cheez-Its or like a Chex Mix.
Mm. All right, all right. Now everybody else, we're going to say our favorite food on three. One, two, three. Sushi. All right, all right. So.
Start from the bottom.
Okay, can I get a drum roll? In fourth place with 74 cans, the middle school boys. All right, all right. In third place, give me another drum roll. At 83, the middle school girls. First runner-up, at 93 cans, high school boys, oh, high school boys, so first place with 132 cans, the high school girls! thing.
All together.
All together. 400 cans of food, which is a really awesome thing. It's gonna go to people in like our community that probably need some help and some food. And that's an awesome way that we're serving and loving other people. Now, we have a game for everybody else, but first,
high school girls.
And there's two of you, so you get a lot of responsibility tonight. Right now, like here today. So all of the responsibility is going to them. You guys are going to go back in the back with Christina, and Katie could probably help out too. And you guys are going to choose a movie and three snacks. High school boys, be thinking about, after this, you will get one snack, but you have to select it as a group. And it will all be in a basket. Hold on, high school boys, though. You're not choosing yet. Actually, go ahead. 2 minutes. 2 minutes. We're going to play a little music. You guys got 2 minutes. Think about what snack. Everybody else can just hang out. And tie them for peanut M&Ms if you want something different.
Yes, sir.
What?
We got free fruit chews.
Yeah.
We're fruit chews.
Like Welch's fruit chews, like the package.
Okay. Fruit snacks?
Oh, hot high chews.
No.
They're called high chews.
We'll have to tell Christina exactly what they are. We have to find them. Okay. It is some kind of fruit snack, so disperse.
We sold the bag.
Disperse, it's some kind of fruit snack. All right, sit down, we got a game. Here it comes. Memorial Youth Game. Keep your hands to yourself for so many reasons. One, a pandemic. Two, be kind and nice to each other. Three, don't hit.
Yeah, come on, Cam.
All right. All right, make sure wear your mask. All right, this is a game called I Voted, where we vote for interesting topics. And it's going to be fun. It could get heated, because there are some very, very good things we have to vote on. Number one, here we go. Y'all listen to this. This is big. If we had a youth group mascot, would it be pizza or Landon's beard?
Well, sometimes your beard's long.
Stand up if you want to vote for pizza. Stand up if you want to vote for Landon's beard. All right, Landon's beard is the new Memorial Youth mascot. What time is it?
Can we have a debate?
I don't think we have enough time. So you have 15 seconds. Give me a spokesman.
Okay, we should do pizza because it opens up ideas for a sponsorship, and your beard's not always on your face.
Whoa, that's good, that's good.
Landon's beard, while it's not always existent, it is always in there in spirit. We have pizza like once a month.
All right, all right. It is voted. Landon's beard still gets it. Number two, here we go. Our first dinner when we can eat again at youth group should be one, Chick-fil-A. Two, tacos. Three, Fazoli's. Okay, hold on, we're gonna vote. If you wanna vote for Chick-fil-A, stand up.
I think I have to do this.
Okay, if you wanna vote for tacos, stand up, my taco people. Hey, represent taco people. If you want Fazoli's, stand up. Yeah, Fazoli's, y'all.
Question.
Yeah.
Is it Chick-fil-A with real fries or the chips?
No, we only do the chips. You know that. We only get the nuggets. We get the nugget trays. All right. This next one's good. Here we go. Our first non-social distancing game after COVID.
This is tough.
Number one, Crazy Volley. Number two, Gaga.
Wait.
Who will vote? Wait, if you don't know what Crazy Volleyball is, it's like volleyball without, basically, only rule is if the ball hits the ground and we play with this big, big thing like this. Gaga Ball is this very fun game. It's a mix of dodgeball, foursquare.
And crazy
volleyball. Yeah, sure. All right, who wants to vote for Crazy Volleyball?
Yeah.
Who wants to vote for Gaga Ball?
Gaga.
Whoa! Wow! Everybody loves Crazy Volleyball so much. I didn't know everybody loved Gaga Ball so much. All right. Here we go. Our next voting issue. The next prize we should hand out at youth game. Number one, king-size candy bar. Number two, gift card. Number three, a youth t-shirt. Probably a $5 gift card.
To where?
It depends. It'll be all different places. All right. We're voting. We're starting with number three. Who wants another youth t-shirt? Okay. I picture us doing that fun thing where we throw t-shirts out like this. You know what I'm saying? That's a dream of mine. All right, gift card. Okay. King size candy bar. Yeah, I mean, it's probably going to be prized for a while until we run out. Like next week, we're going to have, just so you know, next week, we will have several games, Minute to Win It games, competing for king size candy bars. So that's going to be fun. And maybe a gift card or two, because kind of like a Thanksgiving party. You know I love parties. All right, last one. This is a big voting issue coming up. Make sure you vote, make your voice heard. The theme of our future COVID is over party. Who knows when, but it's coming at some point in our life. Number one, Hawaiian. Number two, superhero. Number three, Disney. Oh, hold on. We're voting Disney.
Okay.
Superhero.
Sit down.
I don't know. Christina spelled it wrong. All right. Hawaiian. Luau, y'all. Whoa, luau. Let's go. All right. Thank you all so much for playing this super fun game called I Voted Memorial Youth. Remember, vote so your voice is heard. I guess that's almost it tonight. Hey, next week, just a reminder, 6 to 9, we got a little thing to send home with you. We're going to be watching a movie. We're going to send you home with a bunch of awesome snacks. So if you want a bunch of awesome snacks, come. I think that's all.
Can the high school boys stay after and still decide?
Sure.
What?
You actually have like 3 minutes now. So if you're a high school boy and you want to decide on your snack, keep talking about it. I will give you till 7:30. That's 3 minutes. Everybody else, hang out. We got about 3 minutes left. Last thing I was gonna say. Oh, if you don't watch our podcast, you want to check it out, do so. Once we get to Christmas, we'll be doing another awesome giveaway. So you don't want to miss that. Get involved. Search on YouTube. Memorial Youth, you go to that channel. It's got all of our podcast stuff. Go watch it. It's good for you. It's short. It's sweet. It's going to build you up, okay? Cool. You all have your little discussion. I'm going to go back there and answer Grace's question.